There's a project that I'm talking about right now that I may be starting in the next couple of weeks, actually, that I'm very excited about. The problem for me is that I have a kind of a tradition of not talking about things until they're really actually locked in, until the contracts are signed. So I'm not really going to go into any details. Suffice it to say that I may get a part for my wolf. There's a lovely wolf montage, and it's to be shot up in Oregon by up in old growth forest that's never been cut. I'm also going to see if I can't get Papa up there and give us a little more time together. I found that even though we talk every day on the phone and see each other once or twice a week, that when we go off on location together, it's a wonderful opportunity to really spend extended time where you get into the areas that you can't really get into when you're waiting, the phone's going to ring or some, you've got the normal day-to-day home stuff to deal with. Also one last thing, I discovered voiceovers. And I'm absolutely thrilled to have the opportunity to go to work looking messy and ugly. It's such a relief. But sort of like this. Very soon, on Saturday mornings, I want you all there in front of the TV set watching Spider-Man because they call me Daredevil. Blindor by day, superhero by night, and it's a recurring character. But I'm most excited. A couple of days ago, I did, for the first time, the voice of my own favorite, and really only favorite, comic book character from when I was a kid, Silver Surfer. I love Silver Surfer. He is described in the script as the gentle philosopher of the cosmos. And he's laying on a tree over a lagoon with a lion next to him and deer walking around and birds and everything. And he's talking to this lion about how he doesn't understand why men call you beast when there is no hint of avarice in your own body. He man who has dominion over this pale blue wall, but he's a stranger to peace. I mean, he talks about living in harmony and learning from the laws of nature, which don't change depending on who's elected. And living in harmony with each other. It's a wonderful character. And they're talking about spinning it off. It's a guest on the Fantastic Four right now. But they're talking very seriously about spinning it off so it's its own Silver Surfer show. And if they do that, I'm going to literally make them let me go into schools, possibly in a silver suit with padded muscles. I've always wanted abs. I refuse to do sit-ups. The things that he says are so extraordinary, and what an opportunity to get kids' attention and to plant seeds for the future harvest. Okay, the lovelies, on to questions. I don't know. I'm sorry, I should know, but I don't. I just did the show, and actually there's the writer of the original comic book, there's the writer of the series, there's so I guess my answer is what I said in the beginning, I don't know. Sorry. Yeah. I just wanted to know Superman. She said I'm the Superman. Every single minute. I saw him yesterday at Plaza, and Ada's passing was something that concerned me because she was like a second mother to me, and I know for him, aside from his love and friendship, because they were very, very close, I was concerned that in a sense it was like the end of an era. And that kind of thing can very easily turn older people inward in a way that can become self-consumptive. Eventually self-destructive. I got a hand to the sucker. He's got the heart of a lion. He's fine. I will indeed. I will indeed.
I wanted to say that too, because you said something when I was getting autographed, you know, that said about how the kids turn out well, the parents do a good job. So you can tell your father, you did a wonderful job.
Yeah!
Since I got a few compliments, the pleasure of meeting you, to be on free and join your club, is that you are so giving, you make me feel as if I were your friend.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Ever a role you turned down and you later kicked yourself for, which meant like?
No. I actually, I did a film with Henry Fonda some years ago, and one of the pieces of advice that Hank gave me was never turn anything down. Work has its own dignity, everything has value, and you can learn from every experience. Also, as a father and a husband in a fairly difficult time in my profession, I've never really had the luxury of turning things down. I'm constantly on working capital, as most of us are, and really have to take whatever I can. In many cases, it's taken me into dangerous situations, revolutions in Russia, invasions in Somalia, Tiananmen Square in China, not to mention whatever civil wars and social unrest that I've sort of crossed out of the middle of my career. The State Department does keep a close eye on me these days. But I've been blessed in those situations to have had far more wonderful experiences than difficult ones. And like I said, it's not the reviews or the receipts, it's the friends you walk away with. And on that level, I don't regret any job that I've done. At the fan breakfast yesterday, I apologized because I'm very upset because of a film that's out now that was called The Other Man, I think, when I did it. And the sexiest scene in it was me in a hot tub with a lady, and I didn't show anything, so I figured it was okay. But after I finished shooting the film, they changed the name to Sexual Malice. And I'll give you an example of the kind of stuff that they did. There was a scene where I'm driving along in my car, hi, honey, I got the promotion. Cut to my wife. Oh, I knew you would, sweet. I always had faith in you. Cut to me in the car. Well, put the champagne out. We're going to celebrate tonight. Cut to her. Well, it's already on the table. The candles are lit here. I can't wait to see you. Okay, that's the scene I shot. The scene that's in the film is me saying, hi, honey, I got the promotion. And it cuts to a naked woman rubbing oil on her breasts. Then to my wife, da-da-da-da, cuts back to me, cuts back to a naked woman, not rubbing, the camera's pulling back, rubbing, and she's in a sort of black Frederick of Hollywood vendor, rubbing oil all over herself. And then cuts back and forth to my wife and I, cuts back to the woman who is now, and this was the thing that really infuriated me, pulls back and there's a table in front of her with lit black candles, a pentagram, and my 8x10 publicity glossy, for God's sake. In the middle of the pentagram, which she stabs, at which point my car goes off the road or something. Now, what they do is they create a production company to make the film. Then once, and this is the terrible thing about being an actor in film, is that you have absolutely no control of anybody. It's a good thing I'm among friends.
Lord, I'm so good.
What they do is they create a production company and make the film. And then can do anything they want with your performance. For instance, in Guarding Tess, well, I finished about Sexual Malice. And then what they do is they dissolve the production company. So I have had lawyers, I went after them to get an injunction to stop its distribution. There's nobody to go after anymore. There's no legal entity I can deal with. I know where the people are, where their company is, where they live, but that's the legal entity that made the film no longer exists. The film that I did 2 years ago was Shirley MacLaine, Guarding Tess, and Nicolas Cage, Guarding Tess. I had five scenes, four really with Nicholas, and one large scene with Shirley. In the original script, which was wonderful, she dies at the end of the film.